couple of months. I think the tentative date that you have now is February. But I wanted to speak to how that decision was made. And we had a meeting with a very high official at the Ministry of Justice who said that South Africa was, the South African government anyway, was very hesitant to host that conference, purely because of the fact that if it's hosted in this country, there's a high likelihood that governments from the rest of the continent will feel as though they're going to be marginalized, will feel as though the South African agenda is going to be pushed harder than other agendas. And the, by the South African agenda, he meant the human rights, the constitutional principles, and the fact that we obviously have on-the-ground issues when it comes to LGBT rights, but when it comes to the legal framework, we have quite a progressive legal framework in respect to LGBT rights. So the argument of the South African government was basically that it should be hosted in a different country. We came to a compromise that it would be hosted not by the government, but by the Human Rights Commission, in such a way that it would be owned by an independent entity, and that would then create the safe space that I was talking about earlier, such that, you know, we can actually play that leadership role. We can create a space that is going to be, that's going to bring people together in a way that I think might not be possible in other settings. So it has a very specific role to play in this. The Human Rights Commission does, as does the country and the government. We are obviously, as a country, we have a very, as I said, a progressive legal framework. But at the same time, we do need to be responsive to some of the most significant challenges that we face in respect of social rights on the ground. In the research that we've conducted, we've identified a number of very important areas that we would like to take forward. One of the most significant is secondary victimization when people seek justice. On the basis, or when they've been victims of crimes on the basis of their sexual orientation. We were currently engaging with the National Police Service as well as with the Department of Justice to talk about how secondary victimization can be addressed at a very local level. So those local level initiatives are, to my mind, as important as initiatives that take place in Geneva or that take place in New York. And that's why we want to use conferences like these, we want to use the research platforms that we have, and obviously we want to use our partnerships with organizations such as the Other Foundation to take forward this agenda in numerous different directions.
I think it's wonderful that this conference is finally happening. We have been talking about it forever. I can't remember when we ever did not talk about it. I am wondering if we're giving the South African government a bit of an opt-out by the Human Rights Commission taking it on. And so, while I understand the reasoning for that, I'm wondering why South Africa, in other issues, are so really good at positioning itself as African and very clear on its stance. But when it comes to sexual orientation and gender identity, the water becomes murky very quickly, and all of a sudden we're not sure about whether others are going to see us as African. It's not a question of, I'm just, you know, putting that out there. If the panelists are okay with it, I know you all still have a lot to say, but I do want to take a few questions from the people in the room. And so we'll take a few questions and we'll come back to a wrap-up round. Are there questions out there? There's a question over there. There's another mic over there, this one. I see two questions over there. If you could just keep your hands up. And, yeah, Kai. Okay, let's start with the person to my, please.
Thank you very much.
Please just introduce yourself.
My name is Tino, and I'm from the Eastern Cape Gay and Lesbian Association. Thank you very much to the panel. All your contributions were very meaningful. A lot of notes down from what you had to share. My question is, how do we foster or nurture our relationships with our allies? This is something that I feel, or with the conversation that I've had with a lot of the activists here, we don't nurture our allies enough in our movement. We expect our allies to just feed us all the time. I think that's something that we then need to work on. So for those who are not specifically working in the LGBTI sector, for example, the Reverend, how do you feel we as activists can actually support you in your movement and your work and in a way that makes you more supportive of the way that we do our work. Thank you very much.
Good question.
Good morning, colleagues. I'm Vusili Bambo. The first is a comment to the gentleman with visuals, visual sides. Yes, because I was really touched when I was doing communication with UNISA. And I was thinking also maybe to add architecture, because the structure of the buildings also tells a lot if it's magisterial area or church part there. And then now coming to my first question. My first question goes to the Research Council and Commission. We are having constitutions, good constitutions in the country, but we don't get the constitutions. I don't know where are they packed somewhere, stuck somewhere. And then please, if you can help us so that we get those constitutions when we go around with dialogues within the communities on LGBTIs, their rights and so on, that we can then give them. Some when I'm going around in churches, they don't even know the constitution. If you say, do you know this document? The Bible and the constitution, they know the Bible. But when it comes to constitution, they don't know the constitution. So if maybe we can get access and get the constitutions. Secondly, when we are dialoguing around Gauteng, I would prefer that maybe you are also accessible when we want you to come as technocrats during our dialogues to add more impetus. And then the other question that I had, well, I'll wait for now. Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much. There was another hand right there. Yeah.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. My name is Humphrey from Zimbabwe SRC. And my question is to Finn, and I think I have another one for Fares. What recommendations are you making in terms of your work within the schools for organizations working with LGBT persons wanting to ensure that young persons in the school are protected, that the school system is homo-friendly? Secondly, to Faraz, the South African government stance not to host and actually put to the Human Rights Commission to host the conference, is this not escapist attitude? Because it's taken 4 years for them to make a decision. They could have done that in the first year.
Let's go to the question over here.
Yeah, my name is Gilan Gogo, and I work with Church World Service. My question actually addressed to all the panelists. And when I had a look on the topic today, innovative opportunities, one of my expectations was that we should also talk some more issues that are in our hearts now. We know that so many activists, LGBTI, challenging their government, the statute quo, the patriarchal system in their country, were forced to leave their country and to seek asylum in other countries. So particularly, one of you, how are you engaged to be innovative to work on issues of LGBTI refugees? Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Lisa, can you just go right to the back there, please? Sorry if the sharp lights shining in our eyes and we can't see.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Cass Kai-Polkes from Botswana. The panel is about innovation, but I feel like we're not being innovative in the way that we're discussing this. And I would like to challenge us to move from where we were yesterday, because I feel like we're still stuck in the space that we sort of progressed from with our discussions yesterday. And I would like to ask Iranti, in terms of, well, Jabu, when you speak about what happens in America affecting the affectation culture, what happens in Botswana, what happens in South Africa, what happens in Namibia, for example, how do you feel we can not be subsumed into what's happened in America so that we stand out? And what are you innovatively doing to make sure that we are standing out? Thank you.
Hi, well, I'm being from an organization called SWEG. This is just a faith-based question. We do sensitization with faith-based organizations. Everybody always on the invite, they come. When it comes to sensitization, they are there, but when they actually need to practice what they've learned, I haven't really seen it being practiced. practiced. So what I'm asking you now is, on the topic of sex work itself, within the faith-based organizational group, how do we, which approach do we really use in order for them to really act out the sensitizational option that we are giving them at the end of the day? Yeah?
Right. So you feel the work is being done, but we don't see the results of it. Right. There was another hand over here, please. Okay. Please, you have the mic, and then Lama, I'm coming to you.
Hi, it's Patricia Watson, and my question's for Finn. In terms of education, what are some of the innovative opportunities that we can harness through partnerships, programs, and other areas of the curriculum?
Thank you, Patricia. Lame?
So mine is a comment around, you know, we talk a lot about how politics in America affects our own conversations, our own politics within our own countries. But oftentimes I feel like we also forget about the power of South African politics and the kind of pace that South African civil society, especially around LGBT issues, the pace that they have set, the language that they have set, that we have, that we use a lot in our own countries. You know, the power of South African civil society across Africa, particularly with LGBT issues. And I find that that is sometimes so limiting when we think about how we would have been able to imagine a different language, imagine different approaches, when we're not already kind of trying to adopt South African methods, South African strategies, which are great, of course, and definitely great for South Africa as well, because they have worked in South Africa, we see that. But then again, South Africa is a very different context with a very different history. But, you know, I feel like we should challenge ourselves to kind of step back and say, what would we do, what would our conversation be like if we could, not put aside, but challenge our own politics as well, challenge our own language, challenge our own identities. Mm. So for me, this is very important, coming from Botswana, trying to figure out, okay, how do I work with my own people? Because for a very long time, I was working in a bubble. I was in this human rights language bubble, without the ability to bring it down to my own context, to realize that as a person from a village called Tonota, I have so many aunties, I might even walk into a government office with my LGBT issues, and the person that I'm talking to is a cousin of mine. Mm. What does that mean for my own politics? Is there a different language? But then also to say that, I mean, this is also a big challenge, because as LGBT activists, particularly in other, speaking to you, Mugami, participatory methods of funding, you know, peer reviews, participatory process of selecting who gets funding for this and that, is there's stagnation, because we tend to choose projects that speak to us, to our own politics, and thereby limiting, you know, the space that we might have to allow a different set of politics, which I think speaks to innovation. You know, how do we step out of the bubble that we're right. in, the language bubble, the politics bubble right. that we're in?
And so where does the lack of innovation come from? Because I then wonder, Lame, being a Namibian and agreeing with your statement, it should be, I mean, we can't say to our South African counterparts, dial it down,